Welcome to St. Timothy Lutheran Church for our online worship on the second Sunday after Epiphany. The story we hear today is the call of Philip and Nathanael. An amazing thing takes place in this story. Jesus sees Nathanael. That might not seem like much at first glance, but when we hear this story, let it show us a new way to see the world around us. A new way that we know we are seen by God, and a new way, a Christ-centered way, that we may see other people. I know when you look around at this world, you say to yourself, I wish I could see something different. Well, this story doesn't tell us that the reality of our world changes, but it teaches us to see the world as Jesus sees the world. And in the end, that makes all the difference.
We begin our worship this morning with a psalm that is often used in Christian prayer and liturgy, Psalm 139. It is a psalm that appeals directly, not just to our minds, but more deeply to our hearts, because the psalm arises out of a deep soul experience of being known, loved, treasured, and delighted in. It's a psalm that speaks of how God is all present, all knowing, and it is a knowledge that is not frightening to we who know our limits and our faults. It is a kind of experience of being known by one who loves, treasures, and delights in us. So we pray together the psalm. Let us begin. Lord, you have searched me out. O Lord, you have known me. You know my sitting down and my rising up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You trace my journeys and my resting places, and are acquainted with all my ways. Indeed, there is not a word on my lips, but you, O Lord, know it altogether. You encompass me behind and before, and lay your hand on me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain to it. For you yourself created my inmost parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I thank you, because I am marvelously made. Your works are wonderful, and I know it well. My body was not hidden from you while I was being made in secret and woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes beheld my limbs, yet unfinished in the womb. All of them were written in your book. My days were fashioned before they came to be. How deep I find your thoughts, O God! How great is the sum of them! If I were to count them, they would be more in number than the sand. To count them all, my lifespan would need to be like yours.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Thanks be to you, Lord Jesus Christ, most merciful Redeemer, for the countless blessings and benefits you give. May we know you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly, day by day praising you with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Well, it's time for the children's sermon, but wait a second. I'm missing something. It's you. You're missing. You're missing from being right here and right there and right over there, where we can gather around and we can talk, and you can laugh at me and tell me I'm not making any sense, and sometimes tell me that I look funny, which I often do, and we could laugh and feel comfortable and know that it's good to be together because we love each other. Missing that. But that togetherness and feeling the ability, and we can laugh and share and talk, that's pretty much what Jesus wants for us too. You know, one of the nicest invitations that any of us can ever get is when somebody calls us up on the phone or would knock on our door back in the days when you could knock on the door and just be together. Is, come with me. I have something to show you. Come and see. I can remember so many times when I was a boy, I would wait for the knock on the back door of the house where the field was, and it would be one of the neighbor kids, and they'd say, come on out. And we'll play catch, or we'll get a baseball game going. And maybe we would. And then sometimes while we'd be playing and there would be the grass and somebody, I can remember the day somebody said, come here quick. And there was a snake going through the grass. Or sometimes, like in the winter, we'd be out playing there too, and we'd hear a train, which was only a block away where the train tracks went, and somebody would say, come with me, and we'd go out there, and we'd make snowballs, and we'd throw them, and we'd pelt the train, and we'd laugh, and it was so great. But it all started with an invitation that said, Come and be with me. And even today, I love to get on a text or a phone call or an email where somebody would say, like my friend Rick would say, come over, I have something to show you, I have something to share with you. And I'd go and put on my mask and we'd hang out for a while and it would be good. Jesus did that. He invited people, his disciples, to come and see what I see. Come and know what I know. Come and let me show you some things and tell you some things that I want you to know, because I have some things I need to show you and to share with you, because I want you to know what's in me, and I want to know what's in you. And that's why we read stories about how Jesus touched and healed and blessed and fed people, taught people. And that's why Jesus says, pray to me and share what's on your heart, because I want to know you. And when you pray and read those stories, you know what's in me, because I want you to come and see and be with me. And that is the best invitation of all, because it's an invitation to come and know a great love, the great love of Jesus, who wants you with him always. Because when you're not there, there's something missing. Hope to see you soon.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the first chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. he found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said to him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Very truly I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Today's gospel story, the call of Philip and Nathanael, is among many other things about seeing and being seen. And perhaps when all is said and done today, we come out the other side of this story with a different understanding of how we see God, how God sees us, and how we see the world. A way of seeing that is different than the way we have grown accustomed to in our lives. Our story for today is set in the tiny Galilean fishing town of Bethsaida, the hometown of Philip and Nathanael, and also Andrew and Peter, situated on the eastern side of the Sea of Galilee. This seems to be the type of small town where you can't take a nap under a fig tree without being seen. So it was, at least for Nathanael. The call of Nathanael, it takes place in this way. His friend Philip, who had just been called by Jesus to come and follow him, comes to tell Nathanael and tells him that he has found the Messiah, Jesus, the one whom Moses and the prophets foretold. And after a brief bit of cajoling, Nathanael agrees to meet Jesus in person too. And upon meeting Jesus, he is greeted, I think, in an interesting way. Jesus says, "Nathanael, you are an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." And Nathanael, he's taken aback. I mean, how did Jesus know this about him? They had never met. And that's when Jesus answers. And it doesn't actually clear anything up, but this is what Jesus says: "I know this about you because I saw you. I saw you under a fig tree." Do you hear the disconnect, or rather, do you see it? How does Jesus know what sort of person Nathanael was just by seeing him sitting under a tree? This is our first hint that perhaps Jesus is talking about a different kind of sight. Growing up in a small town, I can relate to Nathanael. You see, if there was a fig tree in my hometown and I fell asleep under it during the day, people would know too. There was a joke around town, perpetuated, I'm sure, by the parents to make a point, but I, it's also not without merit, that you couldn't do anything in our town without being seen and word getting back home. I mean, there are definitely smaller towns population-wise in our nation. Why, I know some of you hail from some of those minute municipalities in Iowa or Wisconsin or Joe Davis County, you know, looking at you, Pastor David. But what made my town, Camp Hill, Pennsylvania, so small was the literal land size. It was 2 square miles. That's it. 15th to 30th Street, 15 blocks of a town. And in those 15 blocks, we had a K through 12 school district, a public library, a swimming pool, a one street downtown, Market Street, some parks, and plenty of ball fields. It was so small that we didn't even have school buses. Everyone lived close enough to the schools that you could walk or ride a bike. As far back as I can remember in elementary school, children were allowed to just go home for lunch. You could make it home, eat lunch, and walk back in the less than 50 minutes before classes started. No matter where you were, no matter where you lived, you could hear the marching band practice. If you sat on your porch on a fall Friday evening, you could tell whether the football team was winning or losing. There were no outskirts, no farmland, nowhere to go without being seen. My parents always said that they knew where I was on any given day if they could walk around and see on whose lawn all the bikes that me and my friends rode, where they were piled up. So as far as seeing and being seen goes, there were no surprises, right? I mean, people could look around town, see what was taking place, and know what was going on. The bicycles are over at Jake's house, so that's where Daniel and his friends are too. So it would seem, to human eyes. And so it would seem for Nathaniel too. When we see Nathaniel in that tiny town of Bethsaida, his fishing boat was probably pulled up on the lawn, and so that's where he was, underneath that fig tree. That's what we see. And based on that, we probably make some assumptions about Nathaniel too. Perhaps when we see him sitting there, we say to ourselves, oh, what a lazy person, right? Resting underneath the fig tree when he should be working. Or perhaps we see him resting and we say, oh, what a hard worker. Having a well-earned rest after a hard day of bringing in fish for his community. Huh. Two different ways of seeing that. That's one of the foibles of human sight. We humans can see the exact same picture and reach two different conclusions. Or sometimes the conclusions that we want to see. I mean, how else? How else, other than our human faltering and failures of sight, can account for those who could see the events of 2 weeks ago? The storming of our capital by an angry mob armed with zip ties and guns, and see that as anything other than an act of terror aimed at the heart of our nation's democracy. How else, other than the limits of human sight, could we do that? Or how, after all these years, even on the eve of yet another Martin Luther King Jr. Day, does our nation and its people still judge people based on the skin color we see rather than the contents of someone's character? Those famous words of Dr. King. Why? It's because we often fail to see the world the way God does. And sometimes we often don't even try. For God is not some neighborhood parent keeping tabs on the community. Because yes, the bikes might be at my friend Jake's house, but we left them hours ago and had walked down to the pool to swim and load up on French fries and ice cream sandwiches. We need to see the world in a different way. We need to see as Jesus sees. And what does Jesus see? Jesus sees something much, much deeper, much more profound, much more important in us and in our world. And in our story today, Jesus sees who Nathanael really is, the truth of his character, the extent of his convictions. So how do we do this? How do we see something deeper, more profound, more important in the world and in those around us? How do we see like Jesus? How do we see the content of someone's character as Jesus saw Nathanael's? A few years ago during a sermon, I talked about Jesus' glasses. You may remember this or not, that's fine. These were hypothetical glasses that we put on to read the Bible. You know, it's a riff. It's a riff off of Martin Luther saying that when we read the Bible, we are looking. We are looking for Jesus and his good news in every word and every verse. Well, today we are called to put these glasses on when we look at the world too. We put on our Christ glasses to see what Jesus sees in the world and to see Jesus in the world. Much like St. Paul in the letter to the Ephesians tells us to put on the belt of truth, the breastplate of righteousness, and the shoes of peace. Well, might we also put on the glasses of Christ? And in so doing, may we look and see in a new way. May we finally see the content of people's character. May we seek truth. May we gaze upon what is just. May we look for grace and mercy and love. When Jesus tells Nathanael that following him means he will see greater things than these, these are what Jesus means. Grace, mercy, love, truth, justice. And as followers of Christ, may we see them too. Amen. guided by Christ, made known to the nations, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all who are in need. O Holy One, we pray for the body of Christ gathered throughout the world, in every land and place, and for all your servants of the gospel, that following Jesus, the church lives out its calling every day to see your truth in the world around us. Hear us, O God. We pray for the well-being of creation, for plants and animals, and for all that God has marvelously made, that we serve as wise stewards of earth, our home. We ask that you would protect all that you have made and inspire our hearts to care. Hear us, O God. O Holy One, we come to you with prayers for our nation and for all nations of this earth. We pray for peace. We pray for justice. We pray for the leaders of governments, that they provide protection to all people, especially the most vulnerable. In this time of division in our country, we ask that you would heal our sight, that you would speak a word of truth and mercy to all those in our great nation. Hear us, O God. We pray for all those who are lacking food or shelter, for those who are sick or grieving. We pray especially this day for Jerry Gard, for Shirley Holstrom, and Eleanor Mashick. Hear us, O God. We pray for all the saints who have gone before us, especially this day. We pray for Nympha Martinez and the whole Martinez family. We ask that you receive her into your gracious and loving arms, that she may be with all the saints and life. Hear us, O God. Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken out loud or in the silence of our hearts. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Let us do as he would do.
we celebrate the Holy and Blessed Eucharist, through which our Lord Jesus Christ comes to us in the bread and the wine, becoming his body and blood, to give us his very self for our life, to know his love, for our forgiveness, and that we may taste eternal life. Let us begin. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Blessed are you, holy God. You are the life and light of all. By your powerful word, you created all things. Through the prophets, you called your people to be a light to the nations. Blessed are you for Jesus, your son, our brother. For he is your light shining in our darkness and revealing to us your mercy and might, to reveal to us the fullness of your divine love and presence. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. And when he had blessed it, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take and eat, for this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks and he gave it to them, saying, "Take and drink from this, all of you. For this is the cup of a new covenant in my blood, given and shed for you and for all people for the remission of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his preaching and healing, his dying and rising, and his promise to come again, we await that day when all the universe will rejoice in your holy and life-giving light. By your Spirit, bless us and this meal, that, refreshed with this heavenly food, we too might be light for the world, revealing the brilliance, the love of your Son. Through him, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, both now and forever. Amen. Filled with hope, we pray the prayer that our Lord Jesus teaches us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will not hunger, and whoever believes in me will not be thirsty. Taste now and see the goodness of the Lord." This is the body of Christ, which is broken for you. And this is the blood of Christ, which is shed for you. Lord, Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you. Now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Let us pray. Christ Jesus, you strengthen us for our journey. Send us forth now from this banquet nourished in body and in spirit to proclaim your good news and to serve others in your name. Amen. Receive now our Lord's blessing. May the love of Christ, which surpasses all knowledge, fill you with all the fullness of God. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen.
Thanks so much for tuning in and joining us for our online worship service. We'll keep them coming as long as we have to, everyone. Before I leave you today, though, I wanted to remind you once again that our annual meeting is coming up on January 31st, so please check the link that Sherry sends so that you can get information about how to join us, because it's very important that we all try and be there if we can. Also, we still have some wonderful ministry opportunities coming up, and one of them is Hesed House. The other one is our blood drive that's ongoing right now, and as well as Feed My Starving Children. Even though we're not meeting to pack food, there's still ways that you can help support that ministry and donate. So please look for more information online about that as well. So until next week, everyone, stay safe and well, and we'll see you later. Bye.
People of God, what are we called to do? Live the love of Christ. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.